Available now from Graphic Audio.
You are my general now, and my assassin. Let all men, let all creatures of Corona tremble before you.
Something terrible is awake, my girl. The Dactyl walks Corona. Quintal! You caught demons! You are a damned thing!
I am with the victor.
I invite you to my home, creature of shadow. You cannot defeat me here. Not now.
I have failed. The demon knows. The demon knows of Elbrion, of Avalon, and the plan.
Be quick and be sure, Symphony!
Go on. You cannot move the damn mountain. Don't you make me death a meaningless thing, my friends. I beg you, get out.
Nightbird! Pony!
They cannot hear you, fool! They are already dead!
No! No, you lie!
Do I?
Wretched beast, I deny you! Son of a dial!
Don't miss the epic confrontation between good and evil in R.A. Salvatore's Demon Wars, Book 1, The Demon Awakens, Part 3. Available now from Graphic Audio.
Attention all hands, attention all hands. This is the captain. I regret to inform all of you that Speaker of the Grand Council, Lord Thornbuckle, is dead. Assassinated on Castle Rock.
It's been confirmed by 3 separate agencies, my lord.
How many were killed or injured?
Lord Thornbuckle and 3 security personnel killed. Sir Mahoney is alive, but in critical condition.
A terrible, terrible situation.
Terrible for some, certainly.
So we're too late and somebody got him first. So what do we do?
Get the rest of them. If he's dead, maybe they won't be watching so close. I could take that yellow-haired slut.
We have a mission. A new mission. Got it?
Yes, sir.
Miranda, what have they told you about it? About who did it?
Nothing. I know the news media says it was the New Texas Militia.
Miranda, I don't think it was the New Tex Militia.
No.
Since Lord Thornbuckle is dead and cannot reply, some might consider it unnecessary to detail the charges that might have been brought against him, but I believe in full and fair disclosure. The fact is, the Familius Regnant is sick, on its deathbed, and if we don't act quickly, the patient could die.
How did Hobart Consoline become Speaker?
I'm Ranger Briley, but you can call me Kate.
What do you make of our Speaker?
He's nobody I'd buy a ranch from. Now, why don't you get down to what you really wanted to talk about?
I want to find out who killed my father, and what kind of hold Hobart Consoline has on my Uncle Hollis, who's after my father's estate.
Now that's a goal we can work on.
We?
Of course we. Hell's bells, sweetheart. I'm not gonna leave you to hunt this hog alone. It's time I went to work.
Serrano Legacy, Book 6, Change of Command, Part 1, from Graphic Audio.
And now, our feature presentation.
audio. A movie in your mind.
Graphic Audio presents Rogue Angel by Alex Archer. Rogue Angel number 16, Polar Quest. Narrated by Nanette Savard. With performances by Colleen Delany, Michael Glenn, Dylan Lynch, Terence Aselford, James Konicek, Tim Carlin, Ken Jackson, Scott McCormick, Joe Brack, Chris Rohan, David Coyne, James Lewis, Tony Nam, Jonathan Watkins, Mort Shelby, and Lily Beacon.
The C-130 Hercules turboprop plane jumped and dropped as the turbulence buffeted it about the sky. Annja Creed, dressed in extreme cold weather gear, issued to her by the U.S. military, clutched at the armrests on her seat, trying very hard not to throw up. It was the first time Annja had ever flown to Antarctica, and she wasn't quite sure what to expect. The flight to New Zealand had been a long one, with three in-flight aerial refuelings supplied by KC-130 supertankers. Annja had watched the experienced crew guide the plane to within a quarter mile of the flying gas station, taking on a full tank of gas, and then continue on its way.
This is getting ridiculous.
If the plane was going to crash, she at least wanted to see it coming rather than sit trapped in her seat. She unclasped her seatbelt and tried to stand.
Ow! Damn! God.
Rubbing her head, Annja clawed her way toward the cockpit. She passed one of the crew on her way and had to resist the urge to scowl at him as he grinned at her.
Is it always like this?
Yep. This time of year is always stormy in these parts. You get used to it after a few trips.
Wonderful.
Clinging to whatever was strapped down, she made her way to the flight deck. The pilot turned and frowned at her.
Hi.
You're supposed to be strapped in, Miss Creed. It's not exactly safe for you to be roaming around.
I got the distinct impression it wasn't safe sitting in my seat either.
We're totally fine. This is run-of-the-mill updrafts, turbulence, and assorted atmospheric anomalies.
Anomalies?
We don't really know what to call them, but they're a normal occupational hazard when you're flying near the bottom of the world.
The co-pilot glanced at her.
You're in no danger.
Guess I figured if the end was coming, I wanted to see it rather than hide from it.
I'd be the same way. If you want to, you can stay as we make our approach.
How much longer?
Maybe 15 minutes. We come in low and fast, so make sure you hold on to something when we hit.
Hit? You guys sure do have a way of putting things.
Well, we don't so much land as we skip and slide on the ice to an eventual stop. Those skis underneath our wheels are there for a reason.
Annja looked out of the cockpit windscreen at the snow blowing right into the glass. The pilot pointed to the instrument console.
Wipers, please.
Wipers.
As the plane started to descend, the pilot and co-pilot laser-focused on their tasks. Annja suddenly felt very much out of place. She turned and headed back to her seat. Once there, she sat down and belted herself in, pulling the slack tightly as the plane pitched like a bucking bronco. To distract herself from thoughts of death by violent impact, she thought back to the letter she'd received shortly after returning from her latest dig. It was from a colleague she'd once worked with, Zachary Guilfoyle. Zach had always been obsessed with prehistory on the planet, and his quest for the strange had made him something of an untouchable among other members of the more conservative scientific community. But Annja had loved hanging out with him. Zach, while a sucker for any bit of the mythical, was also a mean card shark and could spin a tale that often left you wondering what was truth and what was fantasy. His letter had asked Annja to come down to the research station in Antarctica. He was currently there studying something that he would only describe as very interesting. Annja, while intrigued, had put the letter away with no real thought toward going. She had reports to file for chasing history's monsters, after all, and she had some very overdue bills to pay. She was all set to send Zack an email telling him she couldn't go when a pair of men in dark suits, bad haircuts, and disposable sunglasses had shown up outside her loft one afternoon as she returned from a jog.
Are you Annja Creed?
You're telling me that with all the technology you government guys have at your disposal these days, you really have to ask that question? What is that, some sort of leftover ritual you still follow from the Cold War?
Well, you were out jogging.
Ah, so it's more a comment on how crappy I look right now. Well, as long as I know. What can I do for you?
The Fed leaned against the railing of the steps, blocking her way to the door.
You got a letter recently from a Mr. Guilfoyle.
Are you asking me or telling me?
He looked over the top of his glasses at her.
Right, yes. I got the letter from Zack. So what?
He's requested your presence at the research center in Antarctica.
Well, if you already know about the letter, I'm assuming you know all about the contents of the letter. So why don't you cut to the chase so I can get in the shower before I get any riper, okay?
We need you to go to Antarctica.
Why?
Because Guilfoyle needs your help. He says you're the only one he'll work with.
What's the big deal in Antarctica?
It's classified.
Of course it is. I assume you guys won't leave until I agree to go?
Something like that.
All right, I'll need a day or so to get my affairs in order and let my boss know that I won't be in.
That's already been taken care of.
Excuse me?
Your boss, he's already been called. He knows not to expect you for about 10 days.
10 days?
Well, it's not like they run daily flights into the research station. Especially this time of year. Weather's a lot worse than usual.
Oh, great.
We need to get you to New Zealand, Miss Creed.
New Zealand?
And then on to Antarctica.
Did you guys already take a shower for me as well?
Not yet.
Annja started up the steps. This time, they moved out of her way.
Good. In that case, I'm going to soak my tired muscles. I'd invite you guys up, but there's no telling what kind of trouble you'd get into up there.
That's okay. We've already seen the place.
Annja started to smile, but something about the way he said it told her he wasn't joking. The slimy bastards had been into her place. What the hell had Guilfoyle gotten himself mixed up with this time? The plane jerked again and seemed to turn slightly. Annja felt as if she'd just been jarred awake. From Brooklyn, she'd been whisked off to the 109th Airlift Wing of the New York Air National Guard based outside Schenectady. From there, she'd been hustled aboard a big military plane and then flown across the world to Christchurch, New Zealand. In Christchurch, the weather was 70 degrees and pleasant. She could have lounged there in jeans and a t-shirt. Instead, the flight crew made her clamber into thermal underwear and extreme cold weather survival gear. The two feds who'd flown down with her from New York City maneuvered her onto the plane and then waved goodbye to her. They'd never told her why she was heading to Antarctica, and she'd given up asking. Her ears popped as the plane descended. It banked again and then leveled off.
Stand by!
Annja clutched the armrests of her chair, willing herself to breathe normally, while her heart pounded like a jackhammer.
You okay?
Annja opened her eyes and saw the crewman standing over her.
Yeah, I think so.
Great. Well, welcome to Antarctica, Miss Creed.
As Annja stepped off the plane, she took in the vast scene before her. She saw snow and ice everywhere, but also something fairly town-shaped some distance away. The pilot glanced where she was looking and pointed.
That's McMurdo. Most of the folks who come down here stop by there first. Last chance at a decent watering hole, too.
It's big! Much larger than I expected any of the outposts down here to be.
During the Antarctic summer, there are between 1,100 and 1,500 people at the station. With over 150 buildings, they've pretty much got something for everyone.
What about now?
When it gets dark like this, maybe 200 altogether.
Cozy?
We don't usually fly this time of year.
How come you did this time?
Orders, Miss Creed. Our orders were to get you down here, whatever the risk.
I appreciate the chance you and your crew took on me. I don't know what the big deal is, but I'll try not to let you down.
He shook her hand, and then headed off to oversee the refueling procedure. Annja felt remarkably warm, despite the frigid temperatures outside. The extreme cold weather gear she wore had certainly proved itself effective in the short term, but she wondered how long it might last in a survival situation. She shuddered at the thought of freezing to death out here. Across the ice, she spotted what looked like a snow cat. The tracked vehicle slowly chewed its way through the snow and ice. A flashing red light atop the cab, and the brilliant red paint made it stand out in the gloom and snow. Annja hefted her duffel bag and stood on the leeward side of the plane, trying to shield herself from the wind as much as possible. At last, the snow cat trundled to a halt almost right in front of her, and the cab door opened.
Annja Creed?
That's me.
Oh, climb on in. I want to get back to town before the weather gets any nastier.
Annja hustled over to the snow cat and heaved her duffel bag into the open door before climbing up on part of the tracks and sliding into the passenger compartment herself. As soon as she did, she felt billows of heat pumping up between her legs. The interior windows were coated with condensation. The driver next to her held out his hand.
Dave Rasmussen, geology.
Annja Creed, I have no idea why I'm here.
I'm sure you'll find out soon enough. Is it too warm in here? Myself, I like to keep it toasty in the cat, but some folks like it a bit more temperate.
I'm fine.
Where are you hailing from?
New York.
Well, I'm outside Anchorage myself.
So this kind of weather doesn't really bother you, huh?
Well, that depends. Now, it's true, Alaska has some of the nastiest weather around, but Antarctica can give her a run for her money if she wants. I've been here before in storms that would make you get down and hide under your bed. Winds howling and screaming outside. You wonder if the station is going to hold or if you'll be buried in snow.
Sounds delightful.
Dave gave her a half smile as he flicked the wipers as snow started coming down outside. Annja glanced back over her seat. In the darkness, she could barely make out the plane sitting in the snow as it was refueled.
The pilot said there was a place to get a drink.
Well, three places, actually. The best one is called Gallagher's, named after a guy who died out on the ice after a heart attack. Our way of remembering him, I guess.
Annja peered out of the windshield. The snow seemed to be falling harder now than it was before.
You weren't kidding about the weather.
Boy, you'll find that's about the only thing no one kids about down here. When we say it's getting bad outside, take us at our word. It's not gonna be nice.
Noted.
Dave pointed at the lights in the distance.
That's McMurdo, what we call Mactown.
Annja tried to pick out details through the dark and the snow, which seemed to be coming in horizontally. She could see the dim outlines of shapes that she took to be buildings. She could just make out a few vehicles, parked in a ragged line with snow already draping over them like a heavy woolen blanket.
Is anyone still awake?
Yeah, I know what you mean. You see the dark and think it's the middle of the night, right?
I guess. I just realized I have no idea what time it actually is.
Well, it's 6 in the evening. If I guess right, most folks are enjoying a nice warm supper right now.
I guess I'd better get squared away and do the same.
Yep. I'm taking you right to your quarters. Not sure how long you're staying here, though.
Oh?
Well, I hear tell you're headed out of town pretty fast. Seems like you've got some folks down here who are keenly interested in getting your eyes on something.
What kind of thing?
Annja, I'm just a guy who digs rocks. Literally. Anything else going on down here? I don't want to know about it.
That sounds ominous.
Well, in case you forgot, you're at the bottom of the world. Something goes on down here, there aren't a lot of eyes looking at it. You know what I'm talking about?
I suppose.
Oh, here we are. Welcome to Mactown.
McMurdo Station housed about 100 buildings of every size. Most were the kind of box shape Annja imagined was the prerequisite for design under the harsh Antarctic conditions. Many had smaller doors and few windows, along with a thick cylindrical tube containing power lines and communication gear. Here and there, someone could be seen rushing through the snow and going into a building. But really, Annja thought, the place looked like a ghost town.
You weren't kidding about it being quiet down here.
You think this is bad? You should visit some of the other stations. Some of them there may be a dozen people. That's if you're lucky. There are a few other isolated joints scattered about as well. Temporary fixtures that we've set up for one reason or another. As soon as the research is done to get dismantled, places like that might have, four people.
Lonely life you guys lead down here.
Well, we find ways to amuse ourselves. I'm going to drop you off here and wait while you stow your gear inside. When you're done, I'll take you down to Gallagher's for a drink.
That's mighty nice of you.
Well, I can use a drink myself, anyway.
Annja zipped up her hood, grabbed her duffel bag, and reached for the door handle.
Ow!
First one's always a killer.
Annja tried again, and this time managed to get out of the snowcat without getting the door kicked back in her face by the wind. Struggling against the wind, Annja could feel the pores on her face freezing. With getting inside her only thought, she groped for the door handle and pushed into the building. A wall of heat and jukebox music greeted her.
Wow, that's some wind.
Yeah, you must be a virgin.
Annja removed her hood and goggles and stared at the main room she'd entered. There was a long wall separating the entrance from the rest of the bottom floor, but she could see a widescreen TV. A few people lounged on sofas and chairs. Some of them were eating. The man who addressed her looked quite young, and his dark skin stood out in contrast to the mostly white environment. Annja grinned.
That obvious, huh?
Yep. Everyone says that the first time they come down here. Like they expected this place to be all warm and sunshiny.
Well, I knew it was snowy, but I didn't think it was quite like this.
Yeah, I know. Your name Annja?
Yes.
Don't ask me how I knew. You're the only one coming down this time of year. Folks with good common sense wait until later in the summer. Our summer, that is.
Annja unzipped her jacket as the man handed her a key.
I guess I'm staying here?
Temporarily. At least that's what I heard. Your room's upstairs, number 5. You need me to show you where it is?
I think I can handle it.
Okay.
You got a name?
Trevor. Trevor Howard.
You don't look like much of a cruise director, Trevor. No offense.
None taken. This is the off-season anyway, but you're in my building, so I like to meet everyone when they come in for the first time.
What do you do here?
Same thing most of us are doing here, trying to stay warm. Enjoy the room.
Trevor turned and went back to his seat on the sofa. Annja grabbed her duffel bag and headed up the stairs to the second floor. She found number 5 easily enough and immediately heaved her duffel bag on top of the bed. She could always unpack later. Her room was Spartan, but she hadn't expected much. A double bed with a drawer underneath it occupied most of the room. She had a desk and chair near one wall and a small television on the table by the door. There was an overhead light and a red lamp on the nightstand. Annja resisted the urge to grab a shower and instead headed back downstairs. She glanced quickly at Trevor's back, but he made no attempt to talk to her again, so she slipped back outside and into the snowcat.
Oh, all set?
Guess so.
Oh, what'd you think of the place?
Like a college dorm.
Sure is. And sometimes the Air National Guard guys have a keg tossing contest down at the bars.
Wonderful.
Oh, you meet Trevor?
I guess you could call it that.
Yeah, he's like that with everyone. But honestly, he's a good guy. You need anything, he'll be there to help you out. Just don't take it personally that he comes off as a pain in the ass.
Okay.
They drove back down the main street and then turned left. Through the snow, Annja could see bright lights.
Neon?
Like I said, gotta make it look like home.
Dave slid the snowcat in next to another vehicle and then killed the engine.
Yeah, we'd better get inside. This weather, even a cab freezes after about 5 minutes.
Annja clambered down again, and Dave waited as she walked around. Then he held the door open for her, and she ducked inside. Dave unzipped his coat and showed Annja where she could hang up her parka.
Drink?
Definitely.
Hey, Pete, give me a beer, will ya? Annja, what can I get you?
Gin and tonic.
The man behind the bar had a white beard, longer than the ones worn by the guys in ZZ Top.
We're out of limes.
That's fine.
Pete slid Annja the drink, and Dave passed some money across.
Hey, first round's on me.
Thanks for the warm welcome.
Annja held up her glass. Dave clinked his beer bottle against it, and then drank long and deep.
Annja sipped her drink and found it packed a wallop. She turned back to the bartender.
Ooh, you put any tonic water in this?
You just got here, right? I figured you could use the extra kick. That flight rattles a lot of people's nerves. I'll send around a plate of hot wings when they're done cooking, too.
Annja smiled and hoisted her glass.
Much appreciated.
My pleasure.
Hey, there's an empty boot. Want to sit down?
Sure. I'm not sure how the heck I'm supposed to find my friend.
Well, Zach will find you, I'd expect.
I guess.
No, seriously, I'm sure he will. He asked me to bring you here so he knows you're in town.
Oh, all right.
Annja frowned into her drink. The people here seemed nice enough, but she wondered what kind of person could work in an environment like this and not go crazy. Dave leaned back.
So, what is it exactly that you do?
Me? Mostly I file reports for a show called Chasing History's Monsters. But occasionally I end up in remote parts of the world in small bars with guys who buy me drinks.
Ooh, interest in life.
It has its moments.
Well, I'm sure Zach will be able to shed some light on why you're here.
No sooner had Dave spoken than the bar's door opened. Annja felt a gust of cold air blow into the bar before the door closed again. She saw a huddled figure stooped over, wrestling with his parka zipper, before finally freeing himself. He turned and headed right for their booth. Zach Guilfoyle hadn't changed much since the last time Annja had seen him. He wore his sandy brown hair cropped close to his skull, and his Romanesque nose protruded like a hawk's beak ahead of him. But his toothy smile made her grin even as he approached. She climbed out of the booth and hugged him.
Oh, it's great to see you.
Oh, glad you made it down intact. Sorry for not being able to speak with you first about all of this, but then some things are better left unsaid until you're face to face. Dave, thanks for picking her up.
Oh, my pleasure.
Okay, well, I'm here. So what's going on?
Oh, gotta get a drink first, Annja. Hold that thought.
Zach smiled at her and walked back to the bar. To Annja, he seemed thinner, as if the weight of all the extreme weather gear he had to wear had stripped him of some of his flesh and bones. She noticed that two men at the bar seemed interested in him, and judging from the grim expressions they wore, they weren't fans. Zach came back with a bottle of beer and sat down across from Annja.
Well, here's to you getting down here safe and sound.
Cheers.
They clinked bottles and glasses and drank. Zach wiped his mouth on a napkin and then glanced apprehensively at the bar.
You okay?
Yeah, it's nothing.
Annja looked at the bar. The two men continued to stare at Zach with frowns etched on their faces.
They don't look nice.
They're not.
Annja took another sip of her gin and tonic. She felt uneasy. Zach's eyes had widened. Annja turned to see that the grim men were headed over to their booth. Neither of the men looked drunk, and both seemed in excellent physical condition. She blinked and kept her eyes closed long enough to determine that her sword was ready, if need be. It hung in space, glimmering faintly. But the last thing she wanted was to explain to anyone how she'd suddenly manifested a large two-handed sword. The larger of the two men, about 6 feet of intimidation with close-cropped dark hair, stopped near their booth and pointed a finger at Zach.
You Guilfoyle?
Yes. Can I help you with something?
Annja watched the man's flinty blue eyes. They never shifted. They just stayed fixed on Zach. The second man hung back a bit, looking around to make sure people weren't taking too much notice of the conversation. He was solid and lithe, and he had a casual manner about him that told Annja he was no amateur thug. The first guy looked Zach up and down. As he studied Zach, Annja sized him up. The most telling thing about him were the calluses on his hands, specifically on the edge of his hands. Martial artist for sure. Annja glanced around casually before looking up at Mr. Menace.
Anything good to hit here in Mactown? I only just got in, so I'm asking.
Who exactly are you?
I'm the woman who asked you what was good to hit around here.
The man pointed at Zach.
I'm thinking he might be a good place to start. Looks like he could use a good beating.
Why?
Because I don't like him. I don't like how he looks, and I don't much like what he stands for.
You're kidding, right? What's not to love about Zach? He's the life of the party. I'll just bet if you and your friend there had a shindig, old Zach here would bring the house down.
He's not invited.
So you're just going to beat him up, is that it?
Yep.
No, that's not what you're going to do. You're not going to touch a hair on that guy. Not one single strand. Now, why don't you and your pal go on back to the bar and you can continue giving us the evil eye? I just had a long flight and I'm really in no mood for this kind of silliness.
If you just flew in, that means you're with him, right?
He hasn't proposed yet, if that's what you're asking.
Yeah, she's with me. What about it?
I don't like either one of you people.
Well, how come Dave here gets a pass? I mean, after all, he's sitting with us. Aren't you mad at him too?
I got no problem with him.
Well, maybe I'm just more lovable.
Well, tall, dark, and annoying, thanks for coming by. It's always nice to know who the assholes are in any town you travel through.
You keep your tongue wagging, and I might forget about my previous hardline stance against beating the crap out of women.
Something tells me you might have already broken that position. You look like just the type of jerk who would beat up a woman for kicks.
Maybe you're right.
Oh, I know I am, and that's fine. Because there's nothing I like better than taking down an idiot like you.
Anya could see his fists clench. The vein in his forehead seemed to jut out a little farther now that she'd riled him up. She glanced around. The other people were paying close attention.
Whoops. Looks like you've got an audience. Maybe you'd better get the twist out of your panties so you can walk back to the bar.
The first man glanced around and then nodded to his friend. He looked back at Anya.
We'll be seeing you again, real soon.
Great. Thanks, welcome wagon. I feel so warm and fuzzy now.
Both men wandered back to the bar, downed their drinks, and then stalked off into the cold night. Once the door closed behind them, the people returned to their tables and friends. Anya could feel more eyes giving her a once-over.
So much for keeping a relatively low profile.
Dave smiled and polished off his second beer.
So, anyone for refill, Zach?
I'll take one.
Anya?
Sure, but let's go with non-alcoholic this go-round.
Dave got up from the booth and headed for the bar. Anya leaned closer to Zach.
Okay, pal. Just what in the hell have you got me mixed up in here?
Zach looked at her, his eyes gleaming in the dim light.
I'm glad you're here, Anya. Seriously. Not just because you always know how to handle guys like that, but because I'm genuinely glad to see you. It's been too long. Too much time has passed between us.
I won't argue that. But the next time you get all sentimental about seeing me, how about not sending the government goon squad to my house?
I'm sorry about that. Wasn't my idea. When you didn't respond to the letter, the people in charge decided a more aggressive approach was needed.
I feel like I'm being worked over for a mob debt here.
Anya looked up as Dave came back, slid into the booth, and set a can of Coke in front of her. He also plopped down a basket of hot wings.
Hey, grub's up.
Thanks, Dave.
You bet. What'd I miss?
Zach here telling me how he likes sending government agents to my home to strong-arm me into coming down to the bottom of the world.
You did that?
Not me. Them.
Oh.
If I don't get some answers soon, I'm hopping the next plane out of this ice cube.
Yeah, you're better off swimming.
Why?
Well, no more flights are expected here, for weeks.
They told me I'd be back within 10 days. I've got work to do back home, you know.
Yeah, well, they lied. Unless it's a vital emergency, no one is going anywhere.
Anya slumped back in her seat and rubbed her eyes.
This day just keeps getting better and better.
Well, it's not so bad once you get used to the place. There's bowling. You like to bowl?
Not particularly, but I guess I could be persuaded, you know, if it's between that and, say, freezing to death.
Oh, darts league too. We compete against the other stations, but we have to call in the results by radio. I think the other teams cheat.
All right. I guess I can make the most out of this. So what gives, Zach?
I found something amazing.
That's not exactly illuminating. And I don't want to think that you're holding anything back.
Zach put his hands to his neck and reached inside his turtleneck. With a great deal of maneuvering, he managed to slide a necklace over his head. He rested it on the tabletop in front of Anya.
This.
It was a simple design of three snakes lying parallel to each other, the curves in their backs suggesting motion. Anya could see the elaborate work done to denote scales, eyes, and parts of forked tongues. She glanced at Zach.
May I?
Of course.
Anya hefted the piece.
Heavier than it looks.
Exactly. And you see how thin it is?
Anya turned it over. It had the thickness of a credit card.
Incredible. Is it lead or pewter or something?
No. We ran it through a battery of tests. We can't figure out what it is. The metal doesn't register.
You're telling me this has no basis in science?
Yes.
Annja turned it over in her hands. The metal seemed to catch any available light and change colors as she moved it in her hands. The illusion made her think that the scales on the snakes could actually ripple.
This is incredible.
I thought you'd say that.
Dave looked over her shoulder as she studied it. Annja passed it to him.
Whoa.
How old is it, Zach?
That's the other curious thing. According to the carbon dating we did, it's over 10,000 years old.
10,000?
I know. It seems crazy.
It seems impossible. There's no way humans could have made this 10,000 years ago. I mean, I'm not a metallurgist, but this is pretty complicated stuff. It would take some seriously skilled people to pull this off.
Dave handed the necklace back. Zach didn't say anything, but kept staring at Annja.
You're not implying... No, there's absolutely no way...
Why not?
Extraterrestrial? You can't be serious.
It's possible, though. You have to admit.
I'm not admitting anything. You've got something curious here, sure, but to think little green men from Mars planted this here is a bit far-fetched, don't you think?
If you've got any better theories, I'm more than willing to entertain them.
I don't have any theories. I just got off a plane. I can use some good sleep, maybe a few pleasant dreams. And in the morning, maybe we'll be able to look at this in a more logical light.
Dave pointed at the necklace as Zach slid it back on.
Where in the world did you ever find that?
I'm on a dig at the base of Horlick Mountain.
You're out on that one, huh? I heard some whispers that some sort of secret dig site was going on somewhere in a trans-Antarctic range. But no one had any idea where it was.
Well, do me a favor and don't tell anyone now that you know. We don't need the publicity.
Annja helped herself to a hot wing and tore into it. Her mouth watered as the hot sauce hit. She wiped her mouth on a napkin and then glanced at Zach.
Why no publicity? Have there been problems?
Sort of. There are a lot of conflicting ideas about how Antarctica should be used. The scientists want to study it because it's a fascinating look back at our own history. Antarctica used to be warm and lush, part of the Gondwana supercontinent. When the continents broke apart, the land started to cool, so there are no fossils here dating later than 25 million years ago. Meanwhile, the business concerns come down here and see the coal, copper, and chromium this place has. If it was up to them, they'd rape this place and leave it for dead.
Wonderful.
Then you've got the various political machinations at work. According to the Antarctic Treaty System, all previous territorial claims to the continent and ice shelf have been suspended since 1961. But the U.S. and Russia...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.